Okay, thank you all for coming. So if you don't, for those of you who don't know me, my name is Bradley Harris, and I am an assistant professor in chemical engineering here at UTC. So today we're going to have a seminar on what it means to be a well-rounded engineer, and we've got three UTC alumni that have come here to answer your questions related to that. So with us we have Lulu Copeland. She has a BS Mechanical Engineering and an MS in Engineering Management from UTC. She currently serves as the Executive Director of Economic and Workforce Development at Chatt State. And other than that, she's also very involved in volunteering. She is involved in things like the Chattanooga Engineers Club, the Chattanooga Technology Council, and she's also a board member of the Chattanooga Area Chamber of Commerce's International Business Council. Also, we have Kayvon Sandrabadi. He has a BSE from UTC as well as an MBA. He has had about 20 years of workforce development with Unum and with Protective Life Insurance. And then we also have Kim Holby, who has a BS in Mechanical Engineering and a MS in Engineering Management. She is a Reactor Engineering Manager with TVA. She's also served as an adjunct faculty with the Mechanical Engineering Department. So what I first thought I would do is let all three of you tell us what you think of when you hear the words well-rounded engineer.
Well, I think being able to support the community in different ways and you get good outcome is what I would think that would mean. So you got to make sure you have the capabilities to do that. You know, make sure your toolbox is somewhat full.
I would take a different approach in the sense that I would look at you as a well-rounded individual who happens to know engineering. Most everything that you're going to do in life, being a well-rounded person is what's going to get you through, getting along with people, and then engineer, being an engineer, that's even more wonderful, but I would look at it as a person.
I think it has to do with your different experience base that you are building while you're in school. What you're interested in, and what you are naturally good at and what you want to strive to become, and looking for ways to get different experiences in that and build your toolbox. And also, it's also we all three kind of have pretty diverse roles in the engineering field now, and it does not necessarily mean that you have to fill a management role to be a well-rounded engineer and bring a lot to the table. So you could be a technical expert in your field and also be a well-rounded individual and engineer by being able to communicate well, being able to write well, and also just know your field as well as you can.
That's great. Thank all three of you for that. Another question that I thought I would let each member take a shot at is, what kind of skills do you think you need to develop to become an effective engineer?
I'll start with that one since I kind of led into that. Of course, your fundamental engineering technical background, of course, is needed to go into the engineering world. What you may not realize, and I don't think what I realized when I was an undergrad, is how important it is to be able to communicate to people that may not have the technical background that you do. So that's going to involve being able to write clearly, being able to communicate speech clearly, and to be able to read the person sitting across from you and how, if they are understanding, if their body language is getting what you're saying, just being able to have that interaction. And it is something that you sometimes have to push yourself out of your comfort zone to get experience in that and get good at it.
She stole my answer. I think emotional intelligence, I think it's sort of in a way that you were going is because a lot of things, you have to deal with people. Anybody that hires you is trying to solve a problem. So they want someone who has critical thinking skills, who can communicate and who gets along well with people. So the messages sometimes that you have to give are hard to understand. They're not tough, they're just difficult and complex. So you have to understand and be savvy enough to understand that this person is understanding, not understanding. So getting along with people and having that emotional intelligence.
Back to some of the, what I said earlier about capabilities, you know, it's you have to learn and continue to learn. So depending on what jobs, what career path you're taking, there's always going to be new things you have to acquire. So lifelong learning is a skill that's needed.
That's great. Kayvon, I thought one interesting thing to hear maybe you comment on is with your background in recruiting and looking for folks like that is what do you think recruiters and hiring managers are looking for when they're reviewing resumes for engineers?
As I said earlier, it's simpler than you may think. Now, if somebody's looking at a resume, they're looking for something in particular, so they may keywords or something they're searching, they want a chemical engineer or whatever. That, having said that, once they get them in the door, it's got to be somebody they like. It's somebody they can get along with. Hey, I can understand what this person's talking about. I feel like I can work with this team. You're going to be working with people and teams. You got to get along with them. They have to like you. It's like a friend. Anybody that you meet, hey, how you doing? My name is John, whatever. You're going to walk away with a particular impression. You either want to go back to that person or you don't. So it really is what they're looking for beyond the technical stuff that you would have on your resume. Once you're there, how do you present yourself? How do you come across? Do you look like someone who can communicate? Can you speak? Can they get along? Can we get along with this person? So that really is what they're looking for.
Lulu, I'd like if you could comment on how important you think it is in being a well-rounded engineer to be involved with community outreach and professional societies and things of that nature.
Well, it kind of go back to the first question. You know, you have to kind of think about how much time you have. When are you available? When my son was young, I chose Chattanooga Engineers Club because the meetings was at lunchtime. I wasn't going to take my time away from him, but then later on I added stuff. So, you know, it's work-life balance, but then there's a personal life too. So at different time in your career path, something's going to make sense for you. It is important to be involved in the community, and also for you don't know when you need that network. So at different times when you need that, you can't just jump into something. So people have to know you for a while to know that what you're saying, you know, you're the person to depend on or to call on your network for the next job or reference or something. So having that network, it's important to go through some of the engineering groups to find that network.
Thank you. I did also notice that all three of you either have an MBA or some sort of master's degree, and I wondered if you could each maybe talk for a little bit about what led you to making that decision to go for that additional degree.
Well, there comes a time when you want to learn additional stuff, that's one. But then also in your career progression, you know, if you look at job postings, you'll see what's required for the next position. And if that's the pathway you want to go, then that's when you decide you want to do something. But you also have to select a degree that makes sense for you, or you would enjoy studying, because I started three master programs before I ended up in engineering management too.
My answer is going to be a little different than what you expect, I assume, because mine was in MBA, it was in business administration, which was an entirely different field. I decided once I graduated, I really did not go into engineering. My mom is very happy that I have an engineering degree, but besides that, I didn't get into it myself. So I got an MBA because I wanted to be in business. But I will say, As far as the master's is concerned, if you're a person that you feel you have discipline and you can get some work experience, then come back and get your master's, do it. If you're just doing it because it's easier, sometimes it's easier. You're in the mode, you're going there, you're gonna go from, you know, undergraduate, I'm gonna get my master's degree. If that's the only reason you're doing it, I would think twice about it. Because the idea of having some experience, then getting that education, it'll be much more fulfilling and it'll have a lot more meaning.
My response is going to follow up really well with what you were saying, because I went straight into the master's program for mechanical engineering, thinking that's what I wanted to do. And as I was working as an engineer at the company that I was with at that time, I actually decided that I was interested in project management. And so that actually pushed me to the engineering management degree. So, like you were saying, it is really important for you to kind of figure out where your career path is going. And I think some, for me personally, I didn't really understand where my path was going until I had a few years under my belt working. And really my career path has changed a lot from a mechanical engineering degree since I work with all nuclear engineers now. So it's just kind of keeping an open mind and not narrowing down what you think you might want, because it might change 5, 10 years down the road.
Definitely. Maybe you could expand on that a little bit about what it was like moving from a mechanical engineering background to working with a lot of nuclear engineers.
Yeah, so just real quickly, how I got hired on at TVA, I was a system engineer for another nuclear plant outside of the state, and I was coming back to Tennessee. And there was a problem that TVA was having, that they were needing some mechanical experience within their core design nuclear engineering group. So that's how I got my foot in the door. And then I took, personally, I was just really interested in designing reactor cores and understanding that nuclear engineering background. So it's something that I kind of fell into, but I'm very happy that I did, because I really enjoyed it. So it took a lot of effort on my part personally, as far as going out, seeking out training, spending a lot of time outside of the working hours, getting myself up to speed on things, getting with mentors within that group to learn how to perform that job and get the fundamentals that I was lacking. But, you know, just keeping an open mind, and if it's something that you find that you're interested in later on, because I didn't realize what I was going to be interested in or where my career path was going to go, starting off in the power utility industry and then where it's ended up. So just keep an open mind.
Great. Thanks for sharing that. I'm not sure if any of you pursued this, but I wonder if you had any thoughts on becoming a professional engineer, any other sort of certificates or things that people should pursue, and what your thoughts are on that.
Any way that you can educate yourself, you'll be better off. Your generation, most of you are gonna live with the technology, with medicine, you're gonna live to be 80, 90, 100 years old. So forget about the fact of whether you're gonna make more money or whatever, but whatever it is that's education that is helpful to you, you think that it's gonna be good, once you get into a field, you're gonna know whether they're gonna pay more for an engineer, a professional engineer or not. But you gotta be selfish and think about yourself. Anything that you can learn, you can get a certification. If you enjoy it and you like it, that's gonna be helpful to you. So think of it as, how am I gonna develop myself? If you're gonna end up getting a professional engineering license just because you think that's what you gotta do, it probably won't be the best. You didn't like the answer?
I think you rejected
that. That was a passive aggressive way of saying it.
I think you rejected that.
Yeah, I echo that, because a lot is really the job you are in and the job you're gonna go after. Some jobs will require PE, some jobs won't, and some job will require you to obtain certain certifications. So it really depends.
I'll add on something. I will say that if there's any possibility that you are going to go into a field that requires that, or that interests you, to do it as soon as you can. because the longer that you wait in your career, it is harder to find time to study, you know, because you, you start down a career path, you start, you know, building your family. It will be harder as you go on, so it is something that you want to take care of as quickly as possible.
Yeah, go ahead.
You guys mentioned about certifications. What type of certifications are there? Are there available that are that was expounded on your engineering expertise? I mean, I didn't know that you can get different certifications. What type of certifications are out there?
For the professional.
Like PMP, like project management professional.
Okay.
That's one. Then different industry has different certifications. So it really depends on, you know, the job area you're in. You know, like nuclear industries has, you know, like the senior reactor operator management, you know.
So your experts, you know, a general engineering degree might not necessarily give you the skills or the training that you need to do certain things, so you have to go out and get certifications on those.
No, so when we're talking about a professional engineer, that's more of, it's a certificate that basically gives you a rubber stamp, right? So if you do kind of design work, they're going to need that because you're beholden to what you've told them that's going to cost and what it's going to be, what it's going to look like and what it's going to do when it's built. And if it doesn't work, then that's very bad for you, right? So things like, especially civil engineers, if they're doing any kind of construction work or they're building things, you need a PE if you plan to do that kind of work because you're going to need it for people to trust you. Okay? So that's what I was getting at with the PE, but there are other certificates out there, again, depending on what kind of field you're going into or where you're going to work.
Right. And for PE, you have to have 5 years of
right.
experience.
Right. So you have to do the engineering training
before
first.
Before you can sit for an exam. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, some of the other ones, like ASQ has, you know, CQE, sort of like quality engineers. So there are lots of them, but it depends on the job you're in.
Thanks. I think the students have probably benefited from hearing about this too. Do you have any tips or recommendations for how to network when you're first starting out as an engineer and how to look for mentors? Just learn how to build yourself as a well-rounded engineer.
As you can tell already, my slant is a little different than the ladies. You can't get up in the morning and say, I'm going to go network. It doesn't work that way. Networking is about getting to know people. You're interested in others, what is it that they're doing. Now, if you're interested in knowing what other engineers are doing, you may be able to go to some kind of committee meeting or something like that. But from a networking perspective, it is about getting to know others. And I think as engineers, maybe some of us are a little more, we're not quite as outgoing as others, so it might be a little more challenging. But as far as finding a mentor, what is it you're looking for? What are you trying to become a better engineer? Are you trying to become a better manager? Are you trying to become whatever? Find someone that you feel like has those qualities, that attributes that you're looking for. And you try to get closer to them. But you cannot get up in the morning and say, I'm going to spend 3 hours networking this week. It does not work that way. So the sooner that you begin thinking about who can help me, again, be selfish about what it is, or who can I help? If you find someone that you can, networking can go both ways. You help them, and then through them, you find somebody else. It's a very slow process. It is not a methodical that you write a thesis, and this is what I'm going to do in the next 3 months.
You know, one good way to network might be volunteering for different, how many of you here have served as volunteer for the Chattanooga Robotics? Anybody?
I see one.
Yeah, and you know.
He's got both hands.
Well, thank you. So when you volunteer, there are other engineers there. There are other people from the community there. And that's a good way to know people and also like-minded people. So I think you have to go to the places that you enjoy going. And if you're helpful and productive, then people see you as someone may want to know.
I agree with everything that's been said. I mean, that's really, you just talk to people in your community. You can use your professors here to reach out to people, because they all know people that have graduated here and are working in industries around the area. Look for, if you're interested in a certain company, you know, look for ways to network with people in that company in a certain field. It's just looking for those opportunities, and don't get discouraged if you haven't found the right person yet. You just keep up those relationships and just continue to build and meet the next person. So it's important to start very early in that. So I encourage all of you, if you haven't started that process, to do that today. And that's why, one of the reasons why we're here. And we're just trying to reach out to you, and it may not be that you're interested in TVA, but through me, or you may meet somebody else and something that you could help get you a job and your career path going.
Thank you. Do we have any questions from students or anything like that? Go ahead.
So, sir, you were talking about having an MBA because you wanted to go into business, and you were talking about having an engineering management degree. So why did you choose MBA over an engineering management, and why did you choose engineering management over an MBA?
So I chose engineering management because I originally thought that I wanted to go into project management. I have not went into project management. I actually manage people. So again, you never know where your career path is going to go. But that's why I ended up choosing that career path. And I wanted to take technical electives. I was not necessarily interested in leaving the engineering field and really getting into the business side of things. So that was really my interest.
They're not going to ask me back again after answering this question. I never worked as an engineer. By the time I was a junior in engineering, I realized that the vision and the dream, the whatever I had about an engineer, where you would come in and they would give you problems and you would solve these things, was not the reality of what was out there. I was going to go sit somewhere, they're going to say, we're going to design this screw, it's going to have to be 3 inches long and whatever, and that was it. So it was not as interactive as I thought. Engineering was different than I thought. So I went ahead and finished the school, but then I decided to go into business, so I decided to get my MBA. So it's not the answer you were looking for, but the bottom line was just getting an experience and being in the business. And one thing that's different about MBA, even as an engineer, if you go into engineering, you want to get into management, what an MBA does, it shows you how business works. Marketing, legal, ethics, management, MIS, all of those things. An MBA program will give you a taste of accounting, all of those things that you need to do well to run a company, whether it's an engineering company or any other company. So I would highly recommend, if you want to get into leadership, that you think about MBA.
I actually started in the MBA program and then switched to engineering management. And the reason is I click better with the engineering professors than I did with the business school professors. So that may not be the answer you're looking for. So it's a personal decision on a lot when it's your career path. Education is really part of that career path. So it's got to make sense for you.
That's a very good question. Do we have any other ones? Okay.
For those of you that have families, how difficult has it been to maintain that work-life balance?
How much time do you have?
Do you have any tips for that regard?
Tips, I was trying to. Okay, I tell you, I'm married with children, and I didn't get married until much later in life. There are advantages to that, and there are disadvantages to that. If you feel like you're going to start a family, there's going to be a time that's right for you. Each of us is going to be different. You're going to find someone who decides you're going to do it. You'll find the balance. You will figure it out. Is it challenging? Yes. Is it rewarding? Yes. You know, you're going to get married, you're going to have kids. Is it tough to get up in the morning and change diapers and go to work? Yes, it's all tough. But it is what it is, and it comes with reward. So that is not something you can plan, in my opinion. Meaning that, okay, I'm going to do this and do that later. It's going to come to you when it comes, you know, greet it with open arms and God be with you, because you're going to need it. I'm telling you.
I know that's what Dr. Elliott and I are thinking right now.
You know, you have to be honest with the people you care about, and you have to be able to communicate what's important to you. So I have to make sure my family knows that I choose to be here tonight instead of having dinner at home. And those are the things that you make decisions out because you think it's worthwhile. And that's where you find balance.
That's a very good answer. I work in an industry that's 24/7. And this is a concern of a lot of people that I work at. So I work at a nuclear plant. We have a refueling outage coming up starting in March. So, you know, day shift, night shift, 7 days a week, 12-hour shifts. So it is something that you have to, if you're in a field like that, or anything that you're doing, for that balance, communicate well with your family, and just have a good support system is what I recommend. Just try to, when you are at home and when you can be really at home, try to set work aside and set up time periods for you are, you know, turning the phone off, turning the laptop off, and just, you know, making sure that at that moment that's your priority. And when you're at work, your work is your priority. And you just have each person balances it themselves. If that makes sense. Like, what is balance for me may not be the correct balance for you. And so it's an individual and a specific family balance.
Thank you. Do we have any others out there in the crowd that might have something? Way back in the back.
If you had to hire an entry-level engineer right now for a position in your company, how would you merit work ethic against degrees and certifications?
Well, your resume isn't going to cross my desk unless you have the necessary degree. And I will take a hard worker most of the time over certain. If I get the sense or if I get feedback that this particular individual is not a hard worker or isn't willing to put the time and effort into learning what they need to learn and getting a product out, that's going to be very concerning to me. Because I can work with someone that's willing to put in the time and effort and get them up to speed, I feel like. Because you're going to have, each one of you is going to have the fundamentals when you leave here. You have the degree. It's just, what are you going to be putting forth on the job? So to me, I would put work ethic a little higher.
The challenge with that is, how do you put a work ethic on a resume? That's the key. You're not going to be able to stand there and say, I'm so-and-so, and this is what I would bring to the table. It'll be just your degree. It'll be what you have done. Going back to what we were talking about, community service, whatever, or the jobs, having worked. So when they look at a resume and say, okay, this individual's been working, maybe not as an engineer, but they've been working all the time. And then they've volunteered in these times. Those are the ways that you can show your work ethic. Otherwise, no matter what it is that you have, no matter how good you are, it's not gonna come across on a resume just on its own. They get thousands and thousands of resumes. So some of that, you know, working with the community, making sure from my perspective, we looked at people who, they were working while they were in school. They were, or if we found someone that was working while they were going to school, that gave us a different impression than someone who just went to school. So work ethic, as much as you may believe it, you gotta make sure, how is it gonna come across on a resume when somebody's looking at it?
And of course, resume don't tell everything about you. So your degree in education gets you in the door, but lack of work ethic will get you out the door.
Yeah, resume's like eHarmony.com. You know, everybody's beautiful, everything is wonderful, but she refused.
Good advice, especially to eHarmony part of it. Trying to think here. What could maybe each of you talk a little bit about some multifaceted experience or some sort of interdisciplinary experience that you've had while working that you think has enabled you to maybe move up the ladder?
Well, the three of us earlier had a conversation about learning language, and what I want to maybe impart is that, you know, even in Chattanooga, a lot of time you're working for international companies now. So multifaceted, maybe getting to know the world a little bit more.
I don't know, just whatever is interesting. What are you interested in? I mean, there's no matter where you go to work, you're gonna be working with a group of people. And all of those people, part of it becomes a culture. What is that culture? How can you fit in that culture? What are those things that you enjoy about what they're doing? There's gonna be opportunities. It's just you gotta be looking for it. That's all. It's not, again, it's not a plan. It's something that, that you have an opportunity to learn something and working with some people, take advantage of it. She was talking about language or different cultures. I mean, literally, there is a company in this town that speaks German. If you can walk in there on your resume and say, I speak German, I promise you, you will get an interview. So whatever it is that you can do, you don't necessarily have to go learn German, but to be a well-rounded individual, what can you do to grow yourself? Again, you gotta be selfish about that. It's a, what is it that I'm interested in? How can I grow? What are the places that I can contribute?
I'll add in from engineering plant world, kind of what I see and how it's helped me grow is, number one, when we have an issue at the plant, primarily the people that we want to talk to are the craft out in the field that have been working on the piece of equipment and they have firsthand knowledge of what happened, if they were, you know, if they're out troubleshooting something. What are they seeing, being out with them, being able to communicate with the craft people. It may require seismic evaluations, so I'm gonna bring in a civil engineer. It may have some type of impact, a nuclear impact, so that's gonna require, you know, one of the reactor engineers. So it's just getting a variety of people in on that troubleshooting team that's going to find the solution. I'll also add, you know, on a lot of our troubleshooting teams, when we have issues arise at the plant, we're needing somebody to be kind of a devil's advocate and be like, okay, we think the problem is this, but, you know, or is that a symptom of the problem? So really, you know, getting into the nuts and bolts and getting everyone's perspective, that diverse perspective from everybody on the team. So I think a lot of your capstone projects and a lot of things that you're doing here kind of helps prepare you for real world on the job type things that you're going to experience. You know, very seldom are you really just in a cubicle alone, you know, doing engineering work. It requires you to be able to communicate with others and get the other people's perspective.
Thank you. While I've got the microphone with you, I thought, oh, we got a question? Yes.
Psychology. I would say that as I left being an engineer and got into management and getting some of those soft skills, some of those come naturally for me, just my personality, but you know, having to have like performance reviews and getting those skills up to speed and being able to help younger engineers. So I would say psychology, because people were interesting. and it's not as easy as going out and fixing a piece of equipment or designing a piece of equipment. Relating with people sometimes is really hard.
I want you to appreciate what you have here, the education that you're getting at UTC. When I graduated from UTC, I started working in a corporation. There were people that had degrees from Harvard. And I thought, oh my goodness, these people are from Harvard, and I've got an MBA from UTC. And I really didn't necessarily appreciate the education that I had. Even though when I was going to engineering school, I had a PhD from MIT teaching, right in the school. I had other PhDs from many wonderful schools. Once I got to work with those MBA graduates, then I realized that some of them were idiots. They didn't know what they were doing. It's just they had a degree, they were wonderful, they looked fantastic, but they didn't necessarily know how to do the work. Appreciate what you're giving me. This is wonderful education. And don't think anything otherwise. And go out and use it the way it was meant to be used. So the answer to your question is that I should have appreciated it more. It took me a long time to realize that the education that I got here was wonderful.
I ended up with electives that I could share with two other people, so I don't think I missed out too much.
By the way, I don't mean to say people from Harvard are idiots.
Just the one.
No, that's not what. Well, ask another question.
any other questions from the crowd? Yes.
It depends on why you did it. Do you know what I'm saying? I mean, the bottom line is, if you can explain why it happened, here's what I did, here's I had a change of career, if there's a reasonable explanation of what it is that you decided to change, you may turn around and say, I fell in love with engineering and I decided to do it, and they would say, oh my Lord, come on in, we'd love to have you. So it depends on, for yourself to answer, why did I change? And if you got the experience, 10 years older, it doesn't matter. It's the right thing. So I would say on a resume, you would explain, here's why, the rationale, why I changed my field, and just go from there. So I don't think it would matter as much as you might think it would matter.
I agree.
She
agrees.
So
somebody
say
you want to
add one thing. You know, no one's going to see what age you are on your resume. I don't put my high school graduation date on my resume anymore. It doesn't really matter. I mean, I obviously have a high school education or equivalent because I have a college degree. So, just knock their socks off at the interview.
She's designing nuclear reactors for guys.
With a mechanical degree.
Oh.
I just want to piggyback on this question. A lot of internships, it's more about internships. A lot of internships, you do a lot of work. Don't really get into the actual engineering. Do people really understand that what goes on when you're doing an internship too, so their expectations might not be as high for the person coming out thinking they might know more than they have to do because they only got to do grunt work when they were doing an internship? I don't know if that made any sense or not.
It's the idea of the fact that you took the internship. That's more important. Yeah, they realize that they have other interns. So it's the idea that you, out of the 10 students, decided to take the internship. That says something about you. That that is more important than what you actually learn. Do you see what I'm saying? So if you're taking the internship, you're taking time out of your life. Instead of going out and doing whatever, you've decided to spend the time. So that says something about you as an individual, as a student, as an engineer.
I want to add one thing. So I had an internship when I was here, and I ended up getting hired on with that company out of college. And so it gives you an opportunity to build relationships, show your work ethic. So it might be grunt work, but if you're doing it well, and if you're showing up on time and putting in the hours, that's important. They're going to want to see that. So it's those type of things. And I hate that sometimes, and it's come through my office more than once, because we don't set up internships well to actually get you to performing work. And a lot of it is because we run out of time before you get into our office. And I apologize for that. I have done it myself. And having, you know, set myself up, I'm going to do better next time. But a lot of it is just show that you have quality work ethic with whatever your assignment may be.
So even though I agree with what he said, going back to your question and yours, so as far as part-time job or internship, it does add to your experience if it's in the field you plan to go in. And even internship, if a place of work didn't manage their interns as well, you're still learning something. So someday, when you are managing interns, you might do better. So, in everything, you can learn something out of it, good or bad, and it's, you know, it's how you process that. So, so the opportunity to learn in part-time jobs and interns is still relevant.
Did you ever see the movie Karate Kid? Wax on, wax off. At the time, he thought, this is the dumbest thing I've ever done, man. This man is just waxing his cars. But then in the middle of the movie, he broke a table. You remember that? So wax on, wax on.
Yeah, back there.
I've been told that the salary an engineer makes coming out of college significantly determines their following salary, whether it's second or third job. Do you find that to be the truth or no?
Now we get into the nitty gritty here. There we go.
So your first salary follows for your second and third job?
So what I've been told is pretty much shoot for the stars for the first job. If I get a low paying salary on my first job, my second one might pay about, you know, the what my first job would have been, kept looking. I just keep hearing about how it's like a decreasing exponential curve, and you know, you get to start out as high as you can.
So I will say, from the company that I have worked in as a manager, and understanding how our salaries work for entry level, we have a range, and we kind of go out for. Okay, in my industry, nuclear industry, I understand what that range and what that median is for an entry level. And so that's where, in my industry, the nuclear industry, that's where you're going to be, entry level. So you're kind of on an even playing field in that industry. But of course, that's a very regulated, you know, industry. And really, I've been in nuclear for so long, I'm not really sure how the rest of the world works.
Yeah, I would answer that in general, in the sense that if the companies are going to be hiring good people, they're going to have to pay. Everybody pretty much knows. So if they hire you tomorrow and they pay you half of what they're paid somebody else, you're going to find out. They're going to have a lot of disgruntled employees. So if you're going to lose your first job because you don't think it's high enough for your second job, you got other challenges. You know what I'm talking about? So maybe it matters if you're making $50,000 a year. So the assumption is that they say he's making $50,000 a year. Well, we'll just give him another $55,000 instead of the $80,000. they won't do that. Hopefully the companies you're looking for, they won't do that, because at the end of the day, it's going to come back to them. People are going to talk to each other, and they're going to say, wait a minute, I'm making 55, you're making 80, and we both just got here. So I know money matters, but this country needs engineers. We're getting engineers from all over the world. So I think you're going to be in a decent market. I would get the first job, get education, get experience, and I wouldn't worry too much about the second job. I don't know.
Hopefully you're happy with the first job. You know, so at least you jumped out of the industry. You know, every job is rated by education and the qualifications, no matter which industry. So it's not going to deviate too much, except from company to company. You know, some company do better than others, pay better than others. But within the company, you know, somebody at entry level is going to be offering similar salaries.
Yeah, I know I'm supposed to be the moderator, but I think if it's all right, I'll add a little bit to that. I would say that for companies, normally if you interview with multiple people and one of them is lowballing you compared to the other two, it's okay to kind of try to renegotiate that. If there's somebody that's not looking to get back up there to where it's competitive with the other companies, it might not be somewhere that you would like to work. It's something I'd say.
What was the most significant decision you've made in your career, and how well did your education at UTC prepare you for that?
I'll go back to just saying that I got a great education at UTC. It took me a while to appreciate it, but everything that I did along after I graduated, in one way or another, was influenced by that education, by the interactions I had with the professors, by the interactions I had with the students, the environment. So I just think I got a good education, and it was helpful all along.
Well, my major career decision, really, I made as a mom. I thought I was going to go, I actually took an adjunct teaching at UTC and also adjunct teaching at Chattanooga State, thinking, I need to have summer off because of my son. But that lasted only 1 year. I ended up applying for a job that's a 12-month job. So you make decisions that fit your... You think you're making decisions to fit your life, but then you figure out what you actually do want. So those are personal decisions you have to make.
You've had time to think about this.
So the biggest decision that I've made was to go into managing people. Like I said before, that was not something that I necessarily sought out originally. And I think the engineering management degree helped me prepare me for that job. And I would say also the relationships that I've built at UTC also helped prepare me for that job. Again, fundamentally, I was prepared to be a great engineer because of the education that I had here. But it also helped me just to grow into the management role as well. So I hope that answers your question.
Thank you.
Go ahead.
What skills separate an engineer from staying like a Charlie level engineer to moving to management?
You know, TEA. I would say a lot of it has to do with how you present yourself in meetings, how you are presenting yourself to your management. It's very important for you to express what your career goals are to your immediate manager and see how you can either job shadow that individual, job shadow another individual at the company. Look for those opportunities. And again, as in with my career path, it took me actually doing some supplemental stuff. Maybe, you know, I've worked my 40, 50 hours through the week, Monday through Friday, and now I'm out shadowing somebody on a Saturday or Sunday because of the next step that I want to take. So it's looking for those opportunities and speaking it, putting it into a plan, writing it down. But also, if you're not getting the results that you want from someone that you've asked for help from, going ahead and seeking it out yourself to look for the opportunities yourself. But as far as management, I think, again, it's very important for you to be able to communicate, and managers recognize that you are taking in other input from other people and you work well with other people.
Yeah, that's a great answer. I was going to say people skills. And then also, believe it or not, if you have more than two people in a room, there's going to be politics involved. You have to find your way around. There's a book called Career Warfare. I highly recommend you read it. It's raw, it's whatever, but it's the reality of what's out there. It's not as beautiful, but people skills are important. And then politics, understanding who's got the power, who's doing what. And then also take account of what it is you want to go, where you want to go. I tried to get into management, and I did get into management because it made more money. It's like, I got to a plateau, okay, how am I going to make more money? Well, you got to get into management. So there are different reasons you get there, but people skills are going to be number one. And then understanding the politics of wherever you are, there's going to be a culture. You need to figure out how that culture works in that environment.
I think as far as taking a management role, you have to care about the people that you're leading. And you also have to care about the organization you're trying to lead. There are a lot of responsibility with that. So it's nice to have the extra money, but comes with it also is a responsibility. I went from managing people and then took an exit to be just a project manager. So I didn't have people I was responsible for, and that's a kind of free, you know. But then I ended up back into management role with people. And so you have to decide whether you care about the people that you're leading and the organization you're trying to go somewhere with it.
That would make you a good manager. But believe me, you're going to get out there and you're going to see managers. It's not a prerequisite. They're not all caring about people. And I don't mean they don't care about people, but they're not as good. They're not, they just got there because of their skills. You're going to be in places because someone has the right technical skills, they put them in management. They're miserable, their team is miserable, but that's how it works.
There was a lady. Yeah, right there.
Hi, my name is
I wore my beard, you know.
have you had challenges, and how have you worked or overcome those challenges?
So I've been pretty lucky, blessed, that I have not had anything directly in my face that I felt like was excluding me because I was female. Number one, I think it's very important for you to not expect special treatment because you're female, but you need to know what you need to know as an engineer. You need to understand what is expected of you and just work. Again, it goes back to work ethic. If you're willing to put in what's required, it shouldn't matter. It's not going to matter. That it's to me, and in my experience, it is less of an issue than it used to be. And I have some female mentors that worked in engineering when it was not that way. But they've kind of paved the road for us. So to me, it is less of an issue than it once was. Another thing that I think impresses people is just you're not willing, you are willing to get dirty. So you just put the boots on, put your coveralls on, and get out there and just, you know, dig in.
You thought I was going to take it then.
Yeah, I was waiting to see what you
said. No, I have to pass that.
Yeah, I think it's best not to even think of that as a challenge, even if it does exist, because you have the skill needed, you have the qualifications, and if you encounter any of that, then you might have to choose some other path. You know, you find an environment that's best for you.
Y'all say minors are. Like, if you got two resumes and they were practically identical, but one had like a computer science one, would that sway your thinking on that graduate?
I think it makes you more versatile. It depends on what the combination is. You know, are they related or not? You know, the more related they are, I think the more meaning it would have. It says something about what it is you can expand and think in a creative way. It can't hurt. But if they're completely diametrically opposed, it may raise a question of why would that happen?
Anything else?
Can't get one, get whichever one it is.
Do we have a question back here? Yeah.
I wanted to ask, how important is it as an engineer to volunteer?
Well, we addressed that a little earlier. As an engineer, it's not more like as an individual. I mean, that's what they're going to see you as, a well-rounded individual. It helps you become a better person. You're helping the community. You have networking opportunities. From my perspective, looking on a resume, this is someone who spent time for the community. So it can't be but anything but positive. But if you're doing it because of that, that wouldn't mean as much for yourself, you know. But I think it's healthy. The panel agrees.
Yeah.
Tell you, I'm 54 years old, okay? I have a 13-year-old daughter. So my answer may not be what you were expecting. I don't see them as related, in a sense that the things that you would say on Facebook, the things that you're interested in, sometimes you don't want people knowing. It's not a good idea. I mean, you may have politics, you may say one little comment. I said that book about career warfare. One little comment, that's it, it turns them off. So I would recommend the people that you really are networking with, trying to, from a professional perspective, trying to get better, learning in life, that they don't necessarily know everything about you. I may be wrong, but it just, you never know what it is that's gonna, you know, they said don't ever talk about religion or politics with people. Because something you might say, they may never show it, but it turns them off. So I think the social thing, you know, it's very easy to type something and go to sleep. But it's out there. I don't know. It's interesting to me how you can get in trouble.
I agree. Internet is forever, so be careful with that. But to answer the social aspect, if you use LinkedIn or sites like that, if you know, keep that professional. And again, that is just a post of really your resume. So LinkedIn is a really good way for you to see what jobs are available. One of the ways that you can network through LinkedIn is to start following industries, companies that you're interested in. So if you get your foot in the door and you get an interview, then you kind of already know the lingo, you kind of know what's current in that industry, you can speak to that, you already show an interest. So I think those things are good. Not all companies use that format. You know, some of the older companies, really TDA doesn't really use that format really well. Some companies do use it really well. But so I think it can be beneficial, but again, it's kind of just getting that foot in the door from the way that I view it. You still have to be able to build a relationship one-on-one in a group setting, be able to communicate verbally as well.
So people do look at your LinkedIn page. Before they meet you, because I do, you know, before a meeting, I do look at people's, just so they know what they're about. So that's a little bit like a calling card. So having a good image there is probably a good thing.
I was referring to Facebook, by the way. LinkedIn is a wonderful thing.
Any other questions?
Have you ever not hired anybody because their social media presence on the front of a few red flags? Is there anything that you specifically look for if they have that on there?
I will tell you the truth if you promise not to tell it. We literally. Pictures are out there. There may have been an incident at one point where someone was Googling and they saw an unusual picture of someone that seemed like they were partying. It seemed innocent, but I don't know if that's the kind of person you're going to hire. So they know everything about you. Just assume, I assume everybody knows my social security number, my bank account. They know everything about you. I mean, it's out there, okay? So if it's something that you're not sure, don't do it. You know, hopefully that's not, but then there's more and more people, then that's gonna go away. If everybody has a funny picture, then you're gonna have to let it go. But at this point, where there's a transition, in my opinion, as the generations are changing, there's more and more information. People are looking, they're gonna do background checks, they're gonna see if you bounced any checks. Whatever it is that tells them something about you as an individual, because they're gonna hire you as an individual first. Then they're going to your degree. First they look at your degree. Do you have the qualifications? Yes. Then they're going to see, is this a person that we want to hire? So it is an individual. No matter how fancy we get, at the end of the day, it's people working with people.
And the answer is yes, because our human resource do look at people's social media pages.
You're a professional. Engineering is a professional field, and we are expected to be ethical because we are making decisions, sometimes really big decisions fall on our shoulders. So if something is kind of throwing a red flag on, you know, social media that kind of questions that, it can be concerning. And I know me specifically, it hasn't prevented me from hiring someone, but I have been in conversations with other managers that they sent me something. They're like, hey, what do you think of this? So just understand you are going into a professional field. And so you are expected to hold yourself at a higher standard.
I think we're about closing out on time. I thought maybe if each of you could give one last, so just to recap, one thing to give advice to the students about plans for the future to make sure that they become well-rounded engineers.
So my piece of advice is don't be scared to try something that is outside your comfort zone. I definitely have chosen a path that has pushed me out of my comfort zone a few times, and it has worked out well for me. there's been a couple instances where I've been like, oh, that was the wrong decision, and thankfully I've been able to, you know, make other decisions that have turned out well. So don't be afraid to take the next leap if it's something that you're interested in. But also, if you're very comfortable with being an engineer, becoming the expert in your field, and staying in that, then don't let anybody push you outside of that either.
The sooner you figure out how to work with people, the better off you are. I think we're in a field that in some ways we may be more introverted, less excited in social events or whatever that is. I don't know what's the right way to say it, but if you find yourself in a shell, get out of it as soon as you can. And it doesn't have to be anything extravagant, anything important. You're gonna be dealing with people for the rest of your life, be it a spouse, family, or working in the environment. The sooner you figure out, and the more comfortable you are with working with people, figuring out what people, emotional intelligence, the further you're gonna go, your life is gonna be easier. So it's gonna be easy sometimes to go back to the formulas and look down and I don't wanna deal with people. And networking freaks me out when I hear, it freaked me out when I heard the word networking. Networking, what does that mean? Do I have to go say hello to everyone? It's not as complicated as that. But if you find yourself that you're averting, you know, social, whatever, being out with whatever, with people, try to get out of that as soon as you can, because you are going to be dealing with people. They're going to see you as an individual, and the further you will go, the more you know how to deal and work with people.
One other thing that I find has been helpful is that I try to follow somebody I admire. One of the questions that was posted to us was about mentoring. I don't really sought out formal mentors. I'm an avid snow skier, so when I'm on the ski slope, I don't really like going to the schools. But when you're on the slope, you can see somebody that with beautiful style, and I try not to stalk. But I will follow that person and copy the way they ski, because you can tell they're good at it. And so in your professional life, and at different stages of your professional life, you'll find different people that you think, I really admire the style of that person. So that could be somebody you want to copy, somebody you want to learn from, you know, but without stalking.
All right. Thank all three of you very much. I think this has been great for the students and for me. So let's give them a round of applause.